that time Jesus would go into Galilee, and findeth Philip, and saith unto him, Follow me. Now Philip was of Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip findeth Nathanael, and saith unto him, We have found him, of whom Moses the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. And Nathanael said unto him, Can there any good thing come out of Nazareth? Philip said unto him, Come and see. Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him and said of him, Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom there is no guile. Nathanael saith unto him, Whence knowest thou me? Jesus answered and said unto him, Before that Philip called thee, when thou wast under the fig tree, I saw thee. Nathanael answered and said unto him, Rabbi, thou art the Son of God, thou art the King of Israel. Jesus answered and said unto him, Because I said unto thee, I saw thee under the fig tree, believest thou? Thou shalt see greater things than these. And he said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto you, Hereafter you shall see heaven open, and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man.
See everyone here today. Hopefully your Lenten struggle is going well. It's certainly true that life is a struggle for almost everyone. And for many, I would say it's a struggle all the time. There's no relief to the struggle for many of us. Across the world, think of all the billions of people, and you think of the struggles that people are going through day by day, just to survive, let alone have a spiritual life, let alone try to have victory in Christ. I think we could all agree and say that life is a struggle. But in this nation, where our material life is most commonly quite comfortable physically, we still struggle. We struggle with disappointments, with failures. We struggle with health. We struggle with tragedy. And we struggle with death. But as Christians, we need to see beyond the surface of our lives, beyond the material world, behind everything we can see. And Great Lent is designed, this Lenten period, is designed precisely to increase our spiritual vision and allow us to do exactly that, to see beyond the spiritual, to see into the spiritual realm and beyond the physical realm. To make our vision more acute is our goal, to help us get a transcendent view of God, not just of our own life in God, but of everyone's life in God. So, we're stepping into our struggle in Great Lent, and perhaps the first week's been hard. Perhaps you've fallen already. Well, today, the readings are providing us with encouragement and hope, because God is going to come alongside us in these words that he gives us today, and inspire us to strengthen our resolve. Teach us simply this, I think, that it's worth the struggle. The spiritual life is worth it. We need to hold fast, we need to deny ourselves, and we need to know that righteousness will have its reward. Our faith is going to become sight. And God will bless us if we'll keep our hand to the plow and continue on. The Old Testament saints that Paul lists here in Hebrews endured despite incredible persecution. I'd say inhuman persecution. They went forward through incredible obstacles. They never surrendered, even unto death. It's hard to imagine such struggle. When we think our struggles are bad, let's think about those that were quenching the violence of fire with their very bodies. Let's think about those who escaped the edge of the sword, and some who didn't escape the edge of the sword. who waxed valiant in flight and were tortured and not accepting deliverance. They would have rather been tortured than deny Christ. And our struggle would seem to recede. But nonetheless, to us, our struggles are real. And so the Old Testament saints that Paul lists gives us a view of how God looks at struggle. First of all, it says of them that they obtained a good report through faith. You see, the Old Testament saints laid up treasure in heaven through these actions, through enduring the struggle. The ones that turned their back on God in the hour of trial are not listed in this list. Their names perhaps blotted out of the book of life, I don't know. But I do know this, that those who endured obtained a good report. Their faith enabled them to press on through obstacles and obtain victory. And so they have treasure laid up for the final resurrection. Their lives will be blessed in eternity. Then God also says something else to encourage us. He says for us, something better has been provided. He writes, God having provided something better for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. You see, there's coming a day when all the dead in Christ will rise, regardless of which dispensation of grace they might have been under, the Old Testament or the New. And they'll rise and meet God. And it says here that the Old Testament saints had something good. They've got a good report, but we've got something better. And so you might ask, what's that something better that we could have? Well, first of all, I this isn't in the book, but we're not being stoned and tortured. Right? We've got an easier path. But I think what God has in mind is not that so much. But he's got this in mind, that in us the Holy Spirit dwells. Right now, we can taste the glory of God in a way that wasn't open to the Old Testament saints who worshiped in temples of stone, where God's glory was manifested in the holy altar. Now, it's manifested in our hearts. And this is truly better. God lifts us up in a way that he didn't lift up the Old Testament saints. And so when we look at their endurance and their time of affliction and trial, we should take encouragement, for we have more strength, the strength of the Holy God within us, to endure in our time of trial, in our struggle of disappointment, when that health problem comes, when tragedy hits, or when death strikes around us closely. We should be able to dig into what God has set into our hearts and triumph and be victorious. Furthermore, he writes, he says this, wherefore, he says, seeing that we're encompassed about with such a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and every sin which so easily besets us, and run with patience the race that's set before us. Particularly, I think here of encouragement in this. It says there's a great cloud of witnesses around us. Do you see them? Do you feel them? Do you sense them? They're here. They're watching. They're waiting. They're praying. They're drawing alongside of us to help us through our struggle. This great cloud of witnesses is not like the jury in a court that judges. This great cloud of witnesses is praying for our salvation, praying for our endurance, and praying for us to be lifted aside and to lay aside every single weight and the sin which so easily besets us. That particular thing that bothers you, that pulls you down. We have encouragement to know that there are innumerable hosts of heaven on our side, supporting us in our struggles, which are real struggles, not to minimize our struggles. We need to lay aside those weights. We need to be encouraged as we go through Lent, as we go through life, that we have support. It may be invisible, but maybe God will open your eyes sometime. You'll see something. Who knows what will happen if we're faithful. Our encouragement is this, that the angels and the saints are there for us, and also Jesus is there for us. He says this, he says, looking to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that is set down before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is sit down at the right hand of the throne of God. Well, Jesus started this race of ours, didn't he? God came down from heaven and showed himself to man. And without that, we never would have gotten anywhere. And then God shows himself. And so he authors our spiritual race. He starts our spiritual race. He awakens in our hearts a need to be with him. He's placed that in us as a creator. That there's a place in our heart, that God-sized hole that St. Augustine spoke about. It's only filled by God. Jesus, he's the author of our race. He's the one who calls us to himself. And also, it says, he's the finisher of our faith. He's going to see us through to the end. He's going to sustain us. He's going to be with us in the hour of trial. When we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we need not fear evil, for he's with us. The innumerable hosts are with us, but above all, he's with us. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. And so we must look to him. He started our journey. He's our destination. He's everything. He's the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and last. And he's the one that in us brings us to himself. You know, not only is he bringing us to himself, but he's bringing us to a great place. He's going to take us where he is. It says that right now he's set down after the ascension, figuratively, at the throne of God, at the right hand of the Father, the Holy Trinity, where they are. That's where we're going to be. That's what God wants for us. He's prepared a place for us, and he wants us to know that his life in us is a testimony of the fact that there's eternal life. His spirit in us calls us to himself, calls us into the eternal kingdom, where he is set at the right hand of God the Father. What a great thing. And the gospel picks up this very same theme. The lectionary is put together by God in inspiration. And God says this in the Gospels. He goes and finds a man named Nathanael. Philip brings him to Christ. And Christ says to Philip, he says to Nathanael rather, he says, I know who you are. You're an Israelite indeed, in whom there is no guile. I will take that as a high compliment. The transparency and honesty, an open honesty, is of great value to God. God's not into lying. He's not into false faces. He's not into hypocrisy. He's not into masks. God's into openness. And so he commends this man, Nathanael, and he says, behold, you're an Israelite indeed, whom there's no guile. And Nathanael is puzzled, and he wonders, how does he know this? How does he know this? And his mind is beginning to turn. This is how Jesus offers faith, isn't it? He speaks to us in a way that he could only have spoken to us. Nathanael was an Israelite in whom there was no guile, and God pointed it out. Sometimes God points out you're a sinner in whom there's no truth, and he calls you to himself. He authors that faith, and so he did it with Nathanael. Jesus says, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw thee. And now Nathanael's mind is spinning. His curiosity was piqued when he said he was an Israelite and knew there was no guile. But when he says that you were under a fig tree and I saw you and I wasn't there physically, he's starting to be drawn out of the material world and into the eternal kingdom, where things are unseen, but they're real. He falls on his knees and says, Rabbi, or Master, you are the Son of God, the King of Israel. What a great, great confession. It's like Peter said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Peter said, upon this rock I'll build my church. The church is made of little stones like ourselves, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, and Jesus Christ being the chief cornerstone. And each one of those little stones, that hopefully we all are, is built there, laid so perfectly, making the same confession. You are God. You are the King of Israel. You are the Son of God. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. This is the confession which places us in the house of faith. This is the confession that which, if lived by, leads us into the eternal kingdom. And so it was that this man saw God. And he met God and submitted himself to God. And he's truly, truly repentant. And truly, truly enlightened and illumined. How great. But Jesus says to him, he says that What you've seen now is encouraging, Nathaniel. What you've seen now, I just gave you a little taste of what's coming. Just a little taste, he says. He says, do you believe because I said to you I saw you under the fig tree? That's just a little thing. That's not much. He says, I'm going to show you greater things than these. He says, I'm going to show you heaven opened and the angels of God descending and ascending upon the Son of God. The Son of Man, he says. You know, there's a tremendous connection between this world and the next. The connection is Jesus Christ. And when we find him, we have the ability to ascend. We don't need to descend, but someday our eyes are going to be opened. And I would submit to you that it's open to us now. When we're spiritually inclined, we have little visions now of the angels of God. We can see sometimes the veil pulled back of that darkness. And we can see like they saw when Stephen was being stoned, they saw into heaven, saw him sitting up there. They saw the angels and they saw heaven open just a little way. And that's what God does for us every day. We've got this communion with our heart, in our hearts with the Holy God of heaven. He's hidden, but we can sense his presence. We feel his strength. We feel the strength of his heavenly host lifting us up. Daily, we have this ability to be in communion with God. This is what Nathaniel was promised. You're going to see greater things than the little things you see now. And so primarily, he was pointing beyond this earth into the eternal kingdom. He was saying, in this life, you'll see great things. You'll see me work. I'll sustain your faith. I'll build your faith. But you're going to see greater things than these. Today, we're celebrating the Sunday of Orthodoxy. And we're remembering that long-fought fight. It lasted from 787 to 843. That's a lot of years. It's almost 70 years. 70 years of struggle in the church over the issues of whether there should be icons or not. It was a long fight. It was a long time till victory came over iconoclasm. But today we don't only commemorate that triumph of Orthodoxy. We commemorate also the general triumph of Orthodoxy, of true Christianity, of the true faith, over all heresies and evil. And we see Christ transcendent over all the universe. As such, we should be encouraged by these scriptures we just talked about a little bit today. And we need to gird ourselves and endure. We need to dig deeper and find strength to pass onward in our Lenten struggle, which is a figure of our earthly struggle. We need to go ahead and continue on and press on in our lives, remembering this, that Christ is watching us. Christ is within us, and Christ awaits us in glory. Glory to Jesus Christ.
Let us say with all our soul, with all our mind, let us say.